Mind Wipe, they did Weird Wolf, the Skull Cruncher, Code. Code, they did that one, and Chrome Dome didn't go down in price. So I think it's safe to say that it's not going to affect them that way.
Well, one thing, Brett, those iterations of the Headmasters are very different takes on the characters. When you've got Headmasters like what we're getting next year in Titans Return with Hardhead and Skullcruncher, with those being a lot closer to the G1s, do you think the Function X did not affect G1 Headmasters was because of the different take on them? And do you think that with us getting the Titans Returns, which are a lot closer to G1, that might have more of an effect?
No. I actually would have agreed if you would have said the pricing. I would have been closer to the pricing because a lot of those third-party items are at least as expensive as the vintage, if not more. So for that person that's looking for the cheaper of the two, they might pick a G1 over a third party per se, but since they're close, that's really not an option.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as a different incarnation, you're going to have those diehard Hasbro people, and they're going to want the new stuff, but I still think there's enough diehard vintage guys out there that I don't think the price is going to change. I still stand by the fact I don't think they're going to change. You look at Metroplex when they came out with the Generations, which is phenomenal. It's big. It's huge. It didn't affect the price of the G1. As a matter of fact, I actually saw a bigger interest in buying the vintage one. I didn't really see an increase in price, but I saw an increase in interest. So I think when they come out with the G1, even the names, but definitely if they homage the G1 character, I do see an increase in interest.
Well, so Metroplex, his release, I would say, doesn't exactly mirror his original character so much as something like Devastator. Did Devastator affect the price of a G1 Devastator?
No. I was going to get to this, but there are exceptions. When they straight up reissue, then that affects the price. Now, case in point, as everyone knows, is Fortress Maximus. Fortress Maximus took a nosedive drastically. I mean, a complete 100% vintage G1 Fortress Max, $800, $900 average price. Now, $400, $500. That's a big hit. That's a big hit for something like that. Because everyone looks at it and goes, well, I can get it at what? The on-time, on-site, the retailers.
Online retailers.
There you go. Retailers. I couldn't get it out. What are they, $230, $240? You know? I mean, and they're the same. They're not the same. I did a review on that, and everyone knows they're different, but they're close enough that those people that want that little bit of G1 that don't want to pay, it works. And I guarantee, I know I've already seen a drastic decrease in Trypticon since the Platinum Edition came out.
Especially with that Lightning deal that Amazon had for $118.
Yeah, you can't beat that. I mean, a boxed Trypticon, $350. Now, probably $200, $225. And they dropped. So.
Yeah, but Gigastorm hasn't gotten touched, though. Gigastorm actually went up in price. I noticed
that. Different. Different character, different mold. It's different.
Right.
But going right to his question about Headmasters, I don't think it's going to affect it. But then I was starting to think about some other things, but I do want to go back to this topic, but let's see what everyone else has to say, and then I want to go back to the topic because I want to expand on it just a little. But anyone else want to add to this?
Well, I think you're right. I think if anything gets hurt, it'll be the loose Headmasters that people are trying to sell, because the fact that if you can get a new in-box version that's close to the G1 for that, for what retail is going to be. A loose hardhead that may have gone for 25 or 35, 40 bucks complete may not get as much attention if all you're looking for is a hardhead for your collection, when you can go out at retail and get one for $10, $15, $20. So I think maybe the loose figures might see a bit of a drop. But with box stuff, if you want a mint in box one or a sealed in box or sealed, whatever the case may be, that's a radically different thought process on the buying. So yeah, I think you're right on the box stuff, because people are still going to want boxed and carded figures. But right. The loose ones, I think that may hurt the loose ones a little bit. If all you want is that character, why spend $50 for a G1 hardhead when you've got a close approximation and you want one in your collection for $20?
And this isn't the first time, but I'm going to disagree with you on it. And the main reason is because I know enough loose G1 collectors that want G1 but don't want boxes. So I think I stand firm that even the loose prices are going to stay strong. But I mean, we're still, it's my speculation, your speculation.
So. Oh yeah, it's like what happened to the price of Grand Maximus? Because if they've done Fortress, people are wondering, are they going to make a Grand Maximus from that at some point? And then you got all that speculation on, well, do I look for a Grand Maximus vintage? Or do I wait and see if they do one from Encore Fortress? It's all out in the ether.
Right. I will say one thing about that. The funny thing is that as soon as they talked about the reissue of Fortress Maximus, a lot of people dumped their Fort Maxes when they saw how they were doing, and there was a talk about Grand Maxes, Maximus. They all of a sudden there was a bunch of them on the market, and you'll see that. Everyone panics. I got to get money out of this thing before it's worthless, and then they dump it. So you'll see stuff like that. But I think that goes with everything. Anytime there's a drastic change in the market, you're going to see an increase, decrease, fluctuation. Yeah. Then you wait a little bit, and then it's going to level out.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. My Grand Maximus is staying where it's at because I ain't giving mine up.
Yeah, same here. Mine's sitting right there. It's right there, and that's where it's going to stay. Until I decide to move it right there. Oh, right there.
Isn't that how it always works?
You get the dusting, then you can't remember where you put it, so then you reorganize. And it's not because you want to make it look pretty, it's because you can't remember.
Yeah, usually my redusting my dusting comes with the want to move stuff around. It's usually why I'm dusting.
But then you lose your dust footprints on where it was.
Yeah. I know. That's what I said. Then you can't remember.
Oh, my God. It's like 3 centimeters from where it was before. Oh, God. Yeah,
here's the funny part. I do have a tip for that. It's a simple one, of course, but I do it. Before I go, I do. I take a picture. I do. I'll take a picture so that I'll go, oh, yeah, that's where I put that. And I put that there.
Yeah. I love when you have a crammed shelf and you pull everything down and then you start putting it up there and you're like, what kind of wizardry did I perform?
Yeah, I know.
I put this stuff up here. Because the stuff's not going back.
Oh, well, you see this? Back here in the boxes?
Yeah.
I took that out once before. I put it back. I'm like, yeah, everything's back in. I turned around, there was 3 more boxes. And I'm like, they don't fit. How did I get that in there? So it is wizardry.
Yes. So yeah, I have to say that on the topic, I mean, it's pretty obvious. We've seen it in the past that reissues definitely hurt the price of the vintage, or at least bring it down. I would say this question seems to come from a perspective of there's that subset of collector that wants to own the best rendition of a character, and I don't think that is a large set of collectors. Most collectors, I feel, at least when you hit a certain age, most collectors pick a line that was their line and they stick to it. And so they're not really looking for, I want the best version of Skullcruncher. They want the vintage version of Skullcruncher. Like with me, I don't care that I have a Generations Rhinox. I still want the original Beast Wars Rhinox. Because Beast Wars is what I love, and I love the Generations Rhinox. It does not replace my original G1, or my original Beast Wars Rhinox, though. And
by,
so,
by the way, just real quick, by the way, by saying G1 Beast Wars, okay, I totally understand that, and I think that should actually be an acceptable term.
I think so, too. I kind of think it is.
Because you're talking about the first generation of Beast Wars.
Hmm? Well, beyond that, it is connected to the G1 universe.
Correct.
A little bit of comic, a little bit of cartoon, but it plugs in. So yeah. I think...
The problem is you're going to have all these G1 purists. You'll have some that go, oh, no, that's what that means. And I love G1, but even I can look at that and go... Hmm. But, that's, you know, the first generation of Beast Wars, yes.
Yeah. Well, and also, this... Beast Wars is part of G1. I mean, you could not have Optimus and crew waking up in the Ark without the Beast Wars having taken place, because they wouldn't be there. So, I mean, it's already in continuity. You can't say it's not.
Right. Unless I'm a real just a complete G1 purist, and I'm going to say Beast Wars never happened.
You know who you are.
As soon as Optimus woke up, he looked around wondering what happened, and then he got to thinking, he's like, why is there fur everywhere? What is this? did we get a cat?
Someone shit all inside me.
All I'm going to say is
it was a massive attack.
Nope, Dr. Smooth. Go look up Dr. Smooth, because he did one on that.
Oh, yeah, wow. Beautiful.
Beautiful.
I want to kind of chime in a little bit on this because you have to folks out there. Yeah, I have to. You know why? Because, you know, we're talking about, like, you know, okay, the guy that wants to buy just the vintage versus some newer issue or something like that. But the thing I see actually dropping in the market are the people with the third-party ones. They bought a third-party because they want an articulated version of this figure. And I'm seeing it. You guys have all seen it throughout the entire community. People consistently get rid of their Devastators and this, that, and the other because a newer thing comes out that they wanted. It's the same thing. What was it with Prometheus, the Defensor? A lot of those went, like, people just got rid of because they wanted an actual Hasbro articulated version. And that's something I'm noticing in the market is a lot of folks that are in the third party. Not saying that, you know, the third party's better or whoever's what. It's just, I'm noticing this in the community, is some people are just getting rid of theirs because they want to get a Hasbro released of an articulated version of a character they love. That's the big thing I've been seeing. So I don't know if you guys agree with that or not, but that's kind of how I've been following a little bit of this stuff.
Okay.
I don't know if you guys thought of it that direction. I mean, reissue versus vintage, yeah, you got the G1s that do that stuff, but then... Like I said, I mean, you got the folks that want the articulated one.
Yeah, well, I haven't looked in. I mean, I don't do third party, so I haven't really looked into it. But the question is, when Devastator came out, did it hurt Green Giant? Did it hurt Hercules?
Yeah, Hercules. It did. Yeah, I saw a lot of them go away because of that.
Well, I saw Hercules complete on Twitter and other places for $200 to $250 for a complete Hercules. That was just when you talk about seeing a price drop because of a new figure. I think Hercules is one of the best examples in recent memory. But the thing of it is, Hercules is still a fine figure because it represents a different aesthetic. It's more like of a classics Devastator, whereas the Hasbro Titan is more of the G1 Devastator. So you still got, it still has a place in your collection. But yeah, Hercules was one of the best examples.
But you do have the folks that are getting rid of their chug, whatever the heck you want to call it. I know some people hate that term, but that's pretty much what it is. They've been getting rid of all of those because all these Combiner War ones are coming out because they like those better, like the Prowl. The Prowl, actually, the Combiner Wars Prowl looks better than the universe classics, whatever you want to call it.
It's not sticky.
Yeah, it's not
gross out of the package.
Well, I mean, I have two of that mold because I've got Rapido and the G2 Streetwise, as I'm calling him. I'm not calling him what the heck he is on that box.
Street Star. But,
yeah, Street Star. But the mold's okay, but I see where, you know, some folks are like, I want something that's it's better, you know, and that's what they're trying to get into. And it's the same thing with, like, Masterpiece. You see a lot of the Masterpiece that come out, and you got the guy that went out and bought the Classics, and the Classics have been suffering because of the Masterpiece, too. So there is a collector's market in there that's like, I just want the best version of that character.
Well,
and
yeah.
I don't care how it is. I still have the vintage, but I want the best version of an articulated version.
There definitely is. There definitely is. It's just, I think that subset of collector tends to maybe think it's larger than it is. Because, I mean, like we said, if that was a large set of collectors, then a new release like Generation Skullcruncher should kill the price of G1 Skullcruncher. But it's unlikely to do so.
Well, the price I see is the one where you had the fan. Was it Fans Project was the one that came out with the Skullcruncher? The third party?
Make Toys was first Swamper. And then we got the Fans Project, Optimus, Alligator Con, and Crocs.
Right. And I can see the Optimus one, that one will probably stay at a certain level because it's something unique. You might see that from, like, you know, later on if, you know, the club decides to do something with that. But probably. What I see, which I doubt they'll probably ever do, they might not. Maybe it might be a way they'll regurgitate the mold. But a lot of people are complaining about repaints all the time, but it's like, you know, I see these people consistently buying these because they want articulated versions and they're getting rid of the third party because they paid too much for it, apparently. Some people complain, they're like, oh, I paid all this for it. Buy this newer one so then they can turn back around and take the money that they got coming back off of that to buy the toy they want, probably plus three or four other ones they've been wanting for a while. There are a lot of people out there doing that.
Well, the thing for me is that I do. It's like, for example, I have Masterpiece Prowl. I have sold my loose Generations Prowl, and I've got my carded one up for sale now. You know, because the Masterpiece Prowl is a better figure, but it also depends on the. It's like I got Revenge of the Fallen Optimus Prime. I did not sell and get rid of my 2007 Prime because aesthetically they're so different. It's fine being on a shelf. One to me is
2007 Prime is such a good figure.
It is, you know, and you wouldn't have Revenge of the Fallen Prime without the first one. So it just depends on if you like having multiple of the same character and how different they are. You know, I'm not getting rid of if they come out with a Chrome Dome in Titans Returns. I'm not getting rid of Code. Code has some great engineering that really makes it a unique figure.
But what about the one that came out after Code? That larger version, I forget who it was, but there is that version as well. And that one, because of the way the ankles were on it, a lot of people were turned off from it.
Well, I was turned off from it just because it was... Scale is really not... Again, I mentioned this before. When you grow up with G1, scale is not a thing. It never really... Growing up with it, it was never a thing. Other than... Oh, look, I got the Sonicon gift set for my birthday. I want to have Prime and Motor Master. Wait a minute.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so... Exactly. You know, so therefore you've got some issues. But, you know, I've said this before. I've always wanted them to get the UK molds, the Turbo Masters, the Lightformers, the Trakons, get them remade out into the world, either as a Hasbro Toy Shop exclusive, a Big Bad Toy Store exclusive. I've put it on the club set, on the club form, every BotCon. If the molds are available, use them while you can, because once those molds are gone, you're not going to get these figures anymore.
Are we sure that they're not already gone?
Well, I mean, a perfect example was the ones that Brett just held up was Clinch and Pyro.
Exactly.
I have Clinch. I'm still trying to find a Pyro that doesn't shatter. But For crying out loud. Those were great toys. They got the Redux that were this done well.
See? It's good. You should buy this one.
The problem is, though, and I've had this discussion with friends before, they want those UK characters, but with newer molds. And I'm like, because of my age and growing up with the stuff, I don't care about if it's not articulated or not. I want those molds, not new stuff I've already got, but these molds that may not exist for much longer if they're still there, which works back to if they did a new version.
Like the Light Force Trakons?
Yeah. So
there's literally one line and that's it. They didn't do anything else at all.
So if Hasbro made, and this goes back to James's question, if I think it also depends on the vintage figure being what it is. Is it an American vintage figure? Is it a UK vintage figure? Is it a Japanese figure? Like, for example, Carnifex is coming out as a IDW-style Overlord. He doesn't have Power Masters, but apparently you would be able to add Power Masters either when they make it or whatever the case may be. That will be the best way for someone to have an Overlord in their collection, unless they're like Brett says, and they're a G1 collector and you want a specific G1 Overlord. Right. But not everybody can get a G1 Overlord. Because they're so freaking expensive.
Right.
Well, they've really went up in price, too. Like, lately, it's very difficult to even piece one together.
But if in Titans Returns, Hasbro gives us a G1 Overlord, a Titans Return Overlord, that's not going to affect the G1. Because they're so radically different.
I agree.
Well, my question is, when's the last time Hasbro actually used Overlord as an actual name for a toy?
Armada?
That's a long time.
That was Overload.
Overload, sorry.
Yeah. I don't think Hasbro US anyway has ever used it. Cybertron Power Master Gigatron.
That's Overload.
There was a mini-con, wasn't there, called Overlord?
No. That's what I recall.
No, I'm wrong.
Overload had rollout.
But that's the thing. A lot of us have seen this happen where they'll come out with a character just to hang on to a name. That's like that Abominus they did. Just hang on to the name.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I would love to see them dabble with Beast Combiners. It would be nice to see. I mean, Mike here would probably love newer articulated versions of all the Beast figures, which they could easily do with the Combiners if they decide to do it.
They started to do that with Generations. They started to do that. But what I was going to say, and Don, you hit right where I was going. Remember I said I was going to come back?
Mm-hmm.
And the things I was going to talk about were the ones that, like this, the ones that the overseas got that we didn't. And then I was going to mention one other in particular. Now, these are the ones I think that if they do reissue them, if they do remake them, and they try and stay close to the G1 image, I think the prices will go down. Like those two and this one. And I have a reason for this one. This one in particular will go down in price.
Sure, really?
No, this is a Target Master Scourge.
Sure. Yeah.
And the reason being is because this particular piece is overinflated price for what it is. This is a very expensive piece for a piece that's just as common as the other Target Masters were. It, to my knowledge, it never had a shorter run. It was towards the end of this series, but for some reason, this one commands high dollar. And I think because of that, people are less likely to buy it. So I think the price of that one is going to be an exception. I think it will go down.
Well, now, with the
X-Men... Is that because you think folks are army building them? Do you think that's probably why the price
I can't see anyone paying $250 for an army builder.
And besides, if you were going to do that, you could always go with the X-Transbots Andreas that's come out.
Which, by the way, is awesome. Go ahead.
So, and that's, you know, that's 160 some places. I've seen it as low as 149 in some places.
Right.
So, I mean, if you want just a representation, as close as that Andreas is, other than boat mode or space boat mode, it's not quite as accurate.
Honestly, right. that's too much money for a flying bar of soap.
Yeah, but, well, 160 versus 200, 250.
Right.
Just get the Generations one.
Yeah, exactly. But that's what I was saying. This particular piece is it's just inflated. It's an inflated price. I think this will go back down to a more realistic price.
So really, I think it all boils down to it's going to be a character by character basis based on the character and where the original, what country it came from.
Yes. Yeah. But I think for the most part, I don't think they're going to change. Now, the other thing I was going to talk about, and just because we were going to broaden this outside of headmasters, target masters, whatever, I also look at what, when they started reissuing the Toys R Us re-releases of the first series figures.
Commander
Prime, Ultra Magnus, this, that, and the other.
Rodimus Major?
Yes. It did affect the prices.
Absolutely.
But I believe it brought them down to the price they should be. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, but Prowl should not be a $100 figure.
No.
Prowl's about a $55, $60 figure, and that's where it should be. Yeah. I think it's more realistic.
Yeah. And besides, people were still going to buy a Vintage Prime, if nothing else, for the long stacks. Mm-hmm. Because the short stacks did not look
right. Right, they got neutered. They got neutered. Yeah. But the Japanese version didn't. So
was that option.
Safety.
That
exactly.
And then you got the folks out there, and you know, not a lot of us want to talk about it, but we do have our Chinese market out there that's been doing a lot of the KO ones. And
I've not really seen much of that going on in a few years now.
Well, I mean, I think the run for those things have kind of come to like almost a screeching halt because almost everybody has what they want.
There for a while, there was like a Red Mirage and, you know, all these other things, Dinobots. Right.
But just recently, there was a big thing on the Primes again. People selling the Chinese knockoffs as vintage. Mm-hmm. It's happened again. It just happened again on eBay. It was a big, big thing again. And what I'm going to say is the same thing that we do all the time. We talk about save your money, do your research. But each year, I feel we gain more fans, new fans.
Sure.
And we gain older fans that maybe want to start diving into the G1 and this, that, and the other. And now there's just so much non-vintage G1 out there that can be mistaken. It's even more important now to do your research and make sure you're getting what you're buying. So that's always going to be paramount. Just make sure it's what you want, it's what you're paying for.
Right. I mean, if you guys are out there looking and you're looking for, say, like a Devastator, and, you know, everybody wants, like, you know, their vintage Devastator, you need to look at the stamping on some of those. Sometimes the stamping's pretty close, but you can normally tell when you look at the stamping. They will feel the same. I've handled the vintage, and I've handled the knockoff in hand, both together. They literally almost feel identical. Even with the reissue, they all feel almost identical because of the plastic quality. But the transformation sometimes on the KO might be slightly off. You got to look at the stamping. Look at the box, for Christ's sake, because if you don't, sometimes when you look on the back where it's got the whole scan code and all the strats and all this stuff, sometimes you can tell by just reading that they screwed up on the name. Some people will freak out, like, oh, my God, this is awesome. It's almost brand new. That should be a red flag already.
No.
If it doesn't have any shelfware, there's a problem.
Absolutely. I think one of the best ways that you can help prevent getting fooled by those is if you don't want to do your research, if you're just, you know, you want to just get the figure, but you want it to be vintage, go with a trustworthy, reputable retailer. You know, a couple that come to mind, there's megatoyfan.com. Mm-hmm. Maximize your collection, minimize your cost with megatoyfan. Another good one that comes to mind is capturepray.com. Great toys, great prices, great service. They're both really well known. They go to conventions all the time. A lot of the biggest shows like TFCon, BotCon, and all. So yeah, definitely go with people that are trustworthy.
Absolutely. And Jason, just to let you know, when you said absolutely, if it looks crisp and shelf, you know, right out, you know, be warned of that. Be wary. Perfect examples do exist.
Yeah.
Now, don't just go by that.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, they do exist, but 99% of the time, those things are in AFA boxes.
Yeah.
And even Brett, I've been to Brett's house. I've seen some of the pristine box ones he's got, but those weren't easy for him to get.
Yeah.
Plus, he's even said he's lucky. You know, some dude drops off his entire collection. There's a brand new one that's like, you never know. I mean, the guy probably pulled it out in an AFA box.
True.
But
Don, go ahead.
Yeah, but the one thing about Devastator is he's already had so many Encore reissues.
Yeah.
There's been at least three, with one of them in the animated colors. So that's going to be a hard one, because you've got so many Encores already out there, plus so many KOs. You know, depending on the figure, you're going to have to do your research.
Absolutely. But I will say one thing. I will say, yes, definitely. Every convention that we do, out of all the combiners, he's the best seller, he's the most popular. Hands down. Devastator. Over all the others.
Because that's the one that stuck in so many people's brains.
Sure, he had more. He had more screen time.
Yeah, he is the combiner.
So basically, you know, James, you know, that's a great question. I think it's just going to be basically, it depends on the figure, the character itself, and whether the original G1 figure was a U.S. or an overseas figure, because of all the hard to getness, which is not really a word, but
right. Hard to get. True. And then I'll go with, like you
scarcity,
said,
scarcity. We call that.
Well, scarcity or hype. That's what I call on this. This is just hype. All right. It's overinflated. It's hype. It's not worth that much. So that's. Mm-hmm. I think that's.
You know.
I'd say all this stuff will go to a more realistic price. I think it'll go to the price it should be.
Yeah.
You know, so something else that comes to mind, we keep saying, you know, do your research and, you know, all this, that, and the other, and look closely. There's a plethora of resources with information out there. A couple of key ones that I would recommend, though, would be like TFU.info has a pretty decent gallery. Unicron.com has pretty good box scans. But highendtfs.com, which we've mentioned before, actually has like a full breakdown of, you know, the different variants of the knockoffs and how to tell authentic from fakes, and they are very thorough on that part. So I would definitely check there.
Yep,
that's very true. Like, especially if you go to a con and you find like a Ben, and you find like, say, an Optimus Prime Power Master Optimus Prime gun. This is a pristine example. I happen to have two Korean Primes, which Brett actually has the other one. I still have the one. But those Korean Primes, the guns almost look identical until you actually start looking really close. And you'll notice when you look at the original and the KO, you'll find like little ribbing that is on the original that is not on the KO. Now it goes down even to the weaponry.
Are you talking in that horizontal slot on the side?
Yes.
See, because I was always under the understanding that was present on the it was present and both absent on the authentic one.
Well, I know for a fact I had two different versions of Prime. I had the one that had the Apex armor. Then I had the American issue.
Sure.
Those guns were identical. And then I looked at the Korean ones, and they didn't have the ribbing at all.
Well, what say you, Brett? Power Master Prime rifle.
What about it?
On the side of the gun, that horizontal detail, sometimes there's the vertical stripes in it, and other times it's just a just a solid flat area.
I'm trying to remember on that one. I can't remember on that one. I know that there's other ones like Blur's gun. There's different markings on the number of dots. There's two different variations on that. There's different variations. That one I would have to look and make sure. But I do know that the one he's talking about, there was also a difference in the quality. You could actually feel it, and the gun itself was a little lighter. And that's what you're going to find out with the Chinese companies that make these knockoffs. They kind of skimp on the thickness of the plastic. And it just feels...
glassy. I would say glassy is almost like...
coin a term, they feel cheap. They feel cheaper. And there's really no way of saying it other than they just feel cheaper.
Just for conversation's sake, I'm actually going to screen share this. I just pulled this up on TFU.info. Just a second, let me hit the button here. No, not that. There we go. Let me increase the size here. Wasn't it up here in the barrel? Isn't that what you're talking about? Those vertical lines?
No, I believe it was actually in the... I think it was on the back part of the rifle.
Oh, back here? Because I seem to remember up here in the shaft of the barrel itself toward the front, in this hollowed out area, you can't really see if it's pixelated, but there's vertical stripes here, but I've seen other ones I've seen it where that's flat and empty. So.
Well, that's something I noticed when I was doing the actual reviews for those, because it was something that it's one of those things that if you're not really paying attention, because I know a lot of guys, they'll go out there and be like, oh my God, I know what rifle that is, you know? And they go and pick it up, and they're like, you know, okay, I'll sell it to you for like 25 cents, whatever, you know, at a con. Cool. And then they take it home, they think they completed it, and then their buddy that, you know, or they find out through a website or something that, oh, well, it wasn't the real thing. Now they're trying to find those again. So, I mean, that's kind of how it is. Like, even with like Devastator parts.
Oh my God!
Like,
prime example.
Like
I was saying, the drill bit with the Devastator parts. The version with the little pinhole in it in the bottom, and the version without the pinhole in the bottom.
Yeah.
The one with the hole in it can attach to the top of Scavenger.
Mm-hmm.
You can actually just peg on there gently.
Right. I mean, and there are variants, like, throughout the entire thing. I mean, you look at the KO compared to KO to the original, and it's like, yeah, okay, plastic quality, but if you look at, like the Devastator guns themselves, they're pretty close in quality.
Box set versus separate release, even.
All right, Jim, here you go.
Yep.
All right. I always go to this guy. Fred knows his stuff.
Hey, I forgot about him.
All right.
That's
rigid barrel versus rigid barrel, and there's lines on the inside, two lines and one line from here to here. Smooth versus ribbed for her pleasure.
Okay,
there you go.
So they're both authentic. That's what I was thinking.
They are, okay. They are. That's what you were referring to.
All right. Okay. So the KO one.
Something. Hang on a minute. Don, you were going to say something.
Okay. I was just going to say before moving on to the next question.
Yeah.
Did they not also KO the rub signs at one point?
That's yes. Something,
okay, yeah. So don't use the rub signs as a verifier of legitimacy either, because they did KO the rub signs as well. But I just want to double check on that before we move on to the next question.
Yeah, this is a real. Here's the question.
Inside the original instruction booklet, it is not a way to tell an authentic transformer anymore.
Mm-hmm. None of it is. They've reproduced just about everything. I mean, you just need to do your research and go to the websites. If worse comes to worse, ask one of us. We'll get you in the right direction to which website, because we'll find it. But I did want to go on. We had some other questions on Facebook, and I'm going to skip one. And James, he has another one that he wanted to know. He was talking about the sublines or subgroups, to which I was talking about how we talked about our favorite gimmick a while back. Mm-hmm. But I think we're going to keep this one very, very brief and move on to the next one. But real quick, your favorite subline. We'll start with Don.
Headmasters.
I figured as much. Jim.
Combiners.
Nice. Michael.
Did you say, are we doing subline or gimmick, or do they both count as the same thing?
We're not going to do the gimmick, just the sublines.
Sublines.
Remember, this was supposed to be quick. I mean, this is
Fusors?
This is quick for him.
Yeah. Oh, I got you. The Fusors from the Beast Wars line. Gotcha.
Well, now, you could count Beast Wars as a subline of G1 if you want to get technical about it.
I like his answer better. He was more narrow.
Okay. For gimmick, I was gonna say flip changers, but they really want their own subline.
It was kind of a gimmick though. Jason.
G2 GoBots. Also known as the pre spy changers.
Transforming Hot Wheels.
Take a memoir.
GoBots.
Good enough. All right. Now, Michael, I believe it's Resor, he asked, who are the voice actors you would still like to meet? And I'm going to save mine for the last, only because I got a pretty good story about it. But I'm going to go, once again, we're going to go from one side to the other. We'll start with Don.
Okay. Oh, any voice actors or Transformer voice actors?
Basically, I think what they're saying is that because we've talked about actors we've met, voice actors we've met at the conventions, this, that, and the other. Who have you not yet met that you really want to?
I'm going to go with just a blanket for the show, not individual actors. I want to meet the entire cast of the dub of Digimon Tamers. I want to meet the entire cast and talk to them because that is one of my favorite shows, favorite dubs. And I want to meet the entire cast to thank them for such a great job.
If you had to pick one,
probably I can't remember her name right now, but the voice actress that did the voice for Rika, because she did it was such a character that went through a lot of changes, and I just really like to meet her.
Good enough, Jim.
Honestly, it would have to be a toss-up between Christopher Collins or Benjamin Crothers, known to the fandom as Chris Lotta or Scatman Crothers. Simply because, you know, Christopher Collins, he has just such an iconic voice as Starscream and Cobra Commander. I don't know necessarily how diverse his palette was, but just that voice in itself was such an influence in that generation. And then you got the Scat Man. I mean, who didn't love jazz? Not to say anything for Hong Kong Fui or his previously legendary acting career on top of it all. I mean, the Shining and everything else. Not to mention...
The Shining.
Not to mention, he was born and raised like 20 miles from me. 80-some-odd years apart, but still.
Good. Michael?
It's like my backyard.
What do you think, Mike?
I haven't met any voice actors in person. We had that one episode where I got to spend 2 hours talking to Gary Chulk, which was great. Yeah. But
we must remedy this. You must meet them. They are all.
Yeah, I've not met any of them. I would like to meet all of them.
Pick one.
I mean, I guess if you're a Beast Wars fan, you want to meet Scott McNeil, right? Because he's a crazy man
with thousands
of voices. So
you should totally take him to Arby's at 2 in the morning.
I will say this one.
Hey, I'm sure you can probably talk to good old TJ Omega, and he'll probably hook you up.
Well,
I mean, you guys are both in Florida. Come on.
It's a small state.
Gary Chalk is great. He's fun and everything, but Scott McNeil, you're getting a lot of bang for your buck. You really are.
Just in terms of sheer number of characters that he's done.
Oh, and just his personality. God. Just his personality.
I won't get into the details because it gets kind of interesting in a not family-friendly way. But,
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, Brett knows. Brett knows. He was a Psychicon.
Yeah.
But Scott McNeil and John Bailey in the drive-thru of Arby's, with Chad and myself also in the vehicle. Me being the designated driver, of course.
I had to pull over. I was laughing so hard I could not see.
Okay. All right, Jason. Questions on you. One voice actor. One.
I know. And it's an episode that I probably should have been here on, but I completely brain burped on. And I was the one with Paul Eiding because I really wanted to meet him. The guy's a very phenomenal. I mean, he's got a phenomenal career. The guy does so much just even for the Transformer fandom as well. Even just out of charity, he just does it because he wants to. I mean, he's an all-around awesome individual.
Plus, he was in Star Trek.
Yes.
The guy, he's just, I'm sorry. I mean, the guy, he's just freaking cool at everything. And just, he's been a pretty big influence for me. I mean, I was always a big fan of Perceptor ever since I was a kid. And I was one of the kids that, you know, had the microscope. I didn't care it was a microscope. It was cool. But,
Science still, nerd.
I know. I am a nerd. Hey, I got a degree in science. Shit.
So, all right.
Yeah, but like I said, Paul Eiding would be my pick.
All right. Well, I had a pick for the longest time. Well, I happened to get into a conversation with another fan about we're going to try to do something different. I don't know if Mike's going to talk about it or not, but we're going to do something different on the TFTalk.net, and we'll get to that later. But in doing so, I was doing some research, and one of the things we were talking about was autographs and this, that, and the other. And the guy goes, oh, man, you should see all the autographs I have. And he sent me a few pictures. Well, he got an autograph of Leonard Nimoy on a boxed Galvatron. And I thought, that's awesome. That's the most awesomest thing I could think of.
Yeah.
And it got me to thinking about it, and I thought, as much as I love Star Trek, as much as I love Transformers, and the fact that I never got to meet him, he would be my number one voice actor, would be if I could ever meet Leonard Nimoy, which of course I can't. So, but that was my pick. So, I'm also on the hunt. If anyone has any Transformers autographed by him, I'm going to pay heavily for that if it does come out. So, but one of those things, you just never really thought about it. As far as Star Trek memorabilia, his autograph's everywhere. For Transformers, I bet there's not too many.
So. I'm kind of curious for the guys that actually got into watching Fringe, whether they actually got maybe like a DVD set or anything like that, even dealing with that series by being autographed. Because that would be the most recent autographs you probably would have gotten. Because that was one of the most recent things he was on before that happened.
And also for the putting that back on our previous conversation, with his passing, I bet forgeries of his autograph are going to be running rampant. Again, do your research.
Oh, I'm sure. So, but one of those things, that's going to be one I'm going to have to try and find. So, let's see what else we got. What other good questions did we get?
He's reaching in the goodie bag.
Yeah, you get a lot of people agreeing about Devastator. That's good.
Yeah. Everyone agrees about Devastator.
Well, yeah.
Unless you disagree. But you're crazy if you disagree.
Yeah, there's something wrong with you.
Devastator's cool. I like this G2, and I got two different versions of him. So, I mean, what's that say?
I'm just, you know, on a minor tangent, I'm sorry Trypticon won the vote. I was really hoping it would be Omega Supreme.
No. Trypticon deserves it, man.
Scorpionosaur.
I wanted Scorpionok.
I wanted Scorpionok too, but.
I think a play value Scorpionok has the most, but then it's Trypticon and then Omega Supreme. Well, Omega Supreme to me is like one of the most boring characters in Transformers. The only version of him I want is I want an animated Omega Supreme. I don't care about any other Omega.
Well, I hate to say it, but am I the only one that got ticked off when you saw him in the cartoon that the two halves to the big rocket, when they landed, would turn into the whole robot, and you're like, oh, wait a minute. That's not right.
The animators didn't read the instruction booklet.
No, and then the worst is when they actually had him shoot off in the rocket and he still had the launch bay attached to it. Because they would do that every once in a while, too. You were like...
Yeah.
Aerodynamics, what's that?
Poor Omega Supreme.
Just remember... Doesn't that technically make him the first...
By the way, have you guys seen my G2 version of him yet?
I can only imagine. It's probably gaudy.
Oh, my God, you've never seen it.
Is he gray and lime green?
Oh, my God, you have no idea. Give me a second here. I will.
So here's another question we have.
I'll bring him up while we're sitting here talking.
All right.
So this is one we can probably talk on. We actually kind of covered it a bit. Zach Mitchell asks, how much longer before the third party bubble pops?
Yeah.
Okay. If it's okay, I'm gonna go on this one first.
Go for it. When it comes to full term.
Here's the thing. I believe the third party will be sustainable if the companies start having better communication to a degree with each other. If they're willing to reach out and 'cause a lot of these groups have designers that are floating in between groups from what we've seen, using the aesthetics as a guide. They need to make sure that the product they're offering is wide enough and not just 84, 85, 86. Because...
Can we hold our thought here for a second? I got this. Let's get this off our chest before we get into that.
Okay.
Oh my gosh.
There you go. Is Generation 2 Omega Supreme.
Is that not Omega Supreme colors?
No, it's not.
Not at all. The garish brightness, I wasn't sure.
I actually don't
hate that.
He's got
a gold chest. He's got a gold claw.
I mean, if anyone here has a knack for G2 coloring, it's got to be the guy who bleeds G2, so...
That's me. But that's kind of a sneak peek, but I will be doing a commercial and review of him here shortly in the future. I'm saving it because he is almost Christmas colors.
Wow. All
right.
That's my genius award. Go ahead.
Your background is conveniently colored just like your G2 Omega Supreme.
Ah. Yeah, I know. You know.
So,
what can I say? I got to be colorful, man.
Go ahead, Don.
So I believe it's sustainable. I know a lot of the bulk of the money is made from 84, 85, 86, but I think you have enough people looking at the UK characters, the Japanese characters. Maybe if they look at Brave as a possible source of inspiration as well, that if we get a bit more of diverse offerings, so we don't have to choose between four Predakings or three Hounds or whatever the case may be, the money is spread out a little bit better, and we're all, because it's already a small subset of, well, I say small, but it's probably grown over the last several years since the quality of the third party stuff has improved for most everybody. But I think they're going to have to communicate better, not have as much same product, all the Hounds, all the Predakings at the same time, and they look at getting outside that 84, 85, 86 block of figures. That is how – and also third parties be looking at keep up with the parts, keep up with the add-on kits. Those are something that we're not going to get from Hasbro. We're not going to get weapons packs. That's also where your strong suit lies. And original characters like Steel Corps, Assaulter, even though Assaulter is a Broadside homage, it's still a unique take on Broadside.
Very much.
And this guy right here. I know this wasn't a great success for Fans Project. I mean, not like their regular stuff.
That's awesome. I love that.
Yeah, but
yeah, I have contemplated buying that several times.
And this one is compliments of Plasticon. Thank you, sir.
Yes,
but
precisely is that?
This is
a Glacial Lord.
Glacial Lord. Yes, it's a G1 style.
Combiner.
Yes, a G1 style Scramble City combiner from
Headmaster.
And every one of those will plug in to a G1 Scramble City as well.
Right. So,
it's showing the great thing about that thing.
Yeah.
That is awesome. Just show them one of them. Just show them what it does.
Well, Yeah, it's Scramble City. It's
No, not that. The other gimmick it's got, which is freaking sick.
Oh, I really don't. He's all combined.
But, well, yeah, go ahead.
It's your toy. Talk about it.
Well, I wasn't planning on doing this, but okay. There is the head of the robot. Hmm. It won't come out.
It's because you have to flip it around. That wasn't the head of the robot. That was the combining point.
Oh, okay. Uh-huh. Okay. I'm tired. Yeah. It's been a long week.
That's what's crazy about this thing. It's got independent combining points where a head probably should be.
And then you got floating head.
I think the greatest thing about these is that you can have them all. They all look like the very static G1 combiner figures, except for they actually have a bit of articulation to them.
Right.
No, they don't. No, they don't. Only one of them does.
Well, yeah. But the thing I liked about it was the boxes, because they took their time to, like, age the boxes, put, like, stickers on it. Like, your toy would come with some stickers and not to ensure that it was used. Yeah. They went the extra mile on that.
Oh, plus the Korean version after the Japanese one was lost.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And the Korean version looked like something from Brave, which
that one was great. So, I've considered buying these several times. And the other thing I love about them is that if anyone who's read Spotlight Shockwave or Spotlight Grimlock from IDW, it was one of those. I think it was Shockwave. There's a panel where the Dinobots are contemplating taking beast modes on Earth, and the original set of animals that it finds are the dinosaurs they use for Glacial Lord. Or not dinosaurs, but the prehistoric mammals they use for Glacial Lord.
So I think
that might have been the inspiration for when they actually made it.
Yeah. So that's what I think third party needs to do. Not quite as many same products at the same time. Look at getting out of the 84, 85, 86 era. Keep up with the weapons packs and add-on accessories and more original characters. I think if they combine that, we'll all be able to enjoy third party before the bubble's going to burst eventually. It does. Look at Beanie Babies. You know, and I think the same thing's going to happen to AFA grading before too much longer.
Possible.
What I would like to see third party do is make articulated versions of these guys, like G.I. Joe articulated
versions. Well, they do. Well, one company's already doing that to a degree. Like
the Rebel Tech.
We call
the Rebel Tech. No, I'm talking about this size. Yeah. The Rebel Tech ones are much bigger.
Yeah, they're a little
bigger. I was just going to say, Hasbro's calling those Hero Matchers now.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, I mean, they're
Hey, Don.
They're too big. I'm talking about this size.
Right. The one thing you had touched on was about different companies kind of floating back and forth.
Yeah, because it seems like if you look, and this is from what I've read, I can't tell aesthetics from one company to another, like
well,
a designer's touches.
I can show you something.
Okay, please do.
Do you know who this is? Usually not black, but you know who this is.
That's Captain Shark?
Yeah, yes. Captain Shark.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. And he came with a real, real nice display stand. Do you remember who made this?
That was Keith's Fantasy Club?
Yes, KFC.
Yeah. Yeah.
What about this guy? He's a nice guy.
That's Andreas from...
Who made him?
From X-Transbots.
X-Transbots.
And the stand's the same.
Huh.
Now, did they pay for the molding since the stand was already in existence, though?
I'm wondering almost if they have, like, an artist that's working on both companies.
I think they're the same company. That's my opinion. I think they're the same. Because why would you make a stand like this for him, where this port right here for the robot mode there's nothing for him to plug into. There's a top mode here for the spaceship mode, but this is used for nothing. Whereas on this one, this is used in this mode.
Well, the thing of it is, though, is there's some definite quality differences between KFC and X-Trans bots.
Well, it's been mentioned before that they're thinking that they're the same company. When I got this, as soon as I saw it, I ran over, grabbed this one. I'm like, they're the same. So if they're buying the stands from the same company, sure, I guess. All I can tell you is aside from the fact that this has, right here, it says X molding,
mm-hmm.
this is identical to the KFC one.
Okay.
Well, and the rumor is that the designers bounce around between several of these companies.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Because I've heard that before several times where you have people that are bouncing back and forth from two different companies and they work on two or three of the same projects and somehow their whatever gets put into this other company and that's why you have so much.
I'm not going to name companies, but I know one company was facing some difficult times and all of a sudden another company sprouted up doing similar products. And to me, it was more like a segue shifting from one company to the other.
Mm-hmm.
And so I can see that happening. But we're getting off topic.
Yeah.
See, Don, you went. So, Jim, are you ready to go?
Well, we got off topic, so I actually forgot what specific topic we were on. What was the question?
When is a third-party bubble going to bust, or is it going to bust?
Right. Honestly, the only things third-party that I had messed with in the past, there was the one upgrade kit for the G1 Prime that had the fists, the open and close, the axe, and the jetpack and all that. I don't recall where that was made from or that. And then there was the KFC cassette tapes. But as far as third-party overall, I honestly have not really dabbled into it all that much. However, seeing that there's all these different companies and all these different figures that are so similar between them all, it's been so difficult and so tedious to try to keep it all straight that it's almost killed any interest I would have otherwise had in them because of that. You know, because like you'll have $80 for this component and then you know $120 for this component. You know, just, by the time you got the whole thing combined, you're in, you know, $400, $550, however much. You know, and then you've got all these add-on kits and alternate heads and weapons. And then, you know, like if you have one representation of, let's say, I don't know, because we mentioned him earlier, let's just say one representation of Devastator. Let's say Green Giant, okay? And then you also have the, was it Hercules?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And let's just say you try to get an upgrade kit for one, end up you get an upgrade for the wrong one, then you're stuck with it. You know, and there's no real way or means to keep them straight without a lot of hassle. And I think that fact alone has really killed it for quite a few folks. Not to mention, you know, the recent releases from Hasbro. Such as, you know, Titan Wars Masterpiece Devastator. Like I said earlier, affected the market and the value a bit. I don't know. I think that's probably the biggest thing is there's so many, and I think it's just oversaturated. I think if some of these companies were maybe to get together, they could probably do more good. Because a lot of these third-party figures would then be of a similar scale or a similar design. Quality may even improve. I don't know. They might be able to do more stuff with that. But, you know, 8 and 10 different companies or more, I think it's too much work. You know, it's easier to just go for the authentic Takara or Hasbro product. And honestly, in my opinion, I think that it's something just that feels a little more fulfilling, I suppose, in having an authentic, you know, this is Optimus Prime. This is, you know, Ultra Magnus. It's not just, you know, whatever commander or, you know what I mean? It has the Autobot insignia on it. you know. But that's my take on it. You know, just too much work, and sometimes they're hit and miss. Quality and other issues.
Fair enough. Mike, you up next?
Yeah. So, I think I'm going to agree with a lot of points that Jim brought up. I think we already started to see a bit of it already in just the fatigue that the sheer number of third-party items has started to cause. I've heard many people who are into third parties say, you know, I can't keep up with it anymore. So I'm not. When it comes to someone like me, like when third party was really getting its traction, I was in college, I was broke, I couldn't look at the stuff if I wanted to.
I'm still broke.
And now that I can, like recently I was doing some Christmas shopping, and I was going through the third party stuff, and I was like, I don't even know what some of this stuff is, I've never heard of it, there's 800 pages of product, and I don't even know where it is that I'm looking for. You know, it's like there's 50 companies listed here. It's insane. And I think it's just the sheer number of product and the fact that at any one time where you're typically seeing 3 or 4 versions of a character coming out, for whatever reason, third party doesn't stagger this kind of thing. They don't say, oh, that person's released something. Maybe we shouldn't. It's like you have 3 hounds out right now. You had 3 versions of Predaking coming out at the same time. It's just, I think it's getting really ridiculous on that level, and I think that's what's going to kill it. Not that I don't think it's ever going to die because of the quality issue. I mean, obviously, quality has gotten better. The bubble is going to burst because of the sheer volume, I would say, above all else.
Well, pretty much, talking to all my friends, a lot of us are thinking what's going to happen is there's like 5 major companies. You know, you've got your Mastermind, you got your Fans Toys, you got your Fans Project, you got. The top, say, 4 or 5 companies, and if it implodes, they're going to wind up absorbing a lot of the people and the product from the smaller companies that can't make it anymore. So we're going to be left with a lot less companies and a lot more dominant ones in the industry. So that's what I hear a lot from some friends and stuff.
And that would make sense. And it's funny, it really is a unique market to Transformers, I feel. I don't know of any other fandom that has such a large third-party presence. You never hear of third-party Star Wars figures or third-party G.I. Joe figures, you know. And there was a time when I really considered this stuff. It's just, for me, it's just too daunting of a task to even try to undertake now. Mm-hmm. It's not a friendly market. There's too much. You walk in, you get overloaded. It's the kid in the candy store sort of thing. It's like, I'm just gonna stay away from it. And if it does eventually implode and it becomes a smaller, more sustainable beast, then maybe one day I'll revisit that market. But
just get this guy. get Carrie, and you'll be fine.
I don't have a need for a Rodimus unless it's a more than Rodimus. Meets the eye Rodimus. Or Rodimus.
Rodimus.
I mean, Rodimus gets an instant pass because it's the official transformer of TFYLP.
Yes. Which we are looking at things and possibilities and hopes and dreams and, you know, fairy wishes and stuff like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
areas.
Yeah, in short, I think yes. At some point, it's got to implode. Everything does at some point, right?
Yeah, hopefully, hopefully it won't be as spectacular as the Beanie Babies, because that was just...
the video game crash from the 80s.
Yeah, you mentioned you mentioned the kid in the candy store, and I just couldn't help but think that poor kid walked into the candy store, all sweet and innocent, and now he's in a diabetic coma. Poor schmuck.
Jeez. I think the only way that's going to implode is if they actually make an E.T. that transforms into a spaceship. And then transforms into a cartridge.
And it's still as faulty as the original.
I'm sorry, I'd buy that.
I totally would. I had E.T. And I fell down that hole that you could not get out of. And you just sat there for hours trying to levitate out. Yes,
you can get out of it.
Speaking of which, have any of you guys seen the Angry Video Game Nerd movie? The movie.
Not yet.
No. It is phenomenal. Get off your duff and watch it. It is so worth it. It's probably one of the best low-budget films I've seen in a long time.
Well, I'd say the same thing about Linkara's movie.
pretty much anything James Rolfe touches is awesome.
The guy's a freaking mastermind. He's an inspiration to me.
Unless it's made by LJN, then it's not awesome. But otherwise, it's awesome.
Not to be mistaken with LGR, because LGR is good. Lazy Game Reviewer.
So, Brett, is it to you then?
Jason?
Okay. Me? Honestly, to be honest, yes, I can see it imploding, but I think the only thing that's going to save it is if they continue doing add-on kits.
Oh, yeah, I don't think it'll ever go away.
Well, put it this way. I had an add-on kit for my G1 Devastator. There was two or three different versions of it out there, but they still sold really well because everybody has one. And you have all these different add-on kits, even for, like, the Masterpiece figures. Add-on kits. That's where the money's at. These... $500 or $600 figures, then what, 2 years later they're only worth a couple hundred bucks? It's not worth it. I mean, it's something that I kind of saw happening with the third party market. It's gonna get so big, all these people are doing all this cool stuff, then all of a sudden it's just gonna crumble. The ones that are actually gonna survive are gonna be the guys who do add-on kits. Repro labels is a perfect standing thing. They make reproduction labels for everything, and they even do add-on kit labels for existing figures, and they also do, like, third-party stuff. They know what they're doing because they know what the market is.
Even doing labels for the Power Rangers Zords now.
Exactly, and that's the thing. That is the hot thing nowadays, add-on kits. It's great to get a third-party figure of something that you don't think Hasbro's ever going to produce. But everybody thought, oh, they're never going to do a Soundwave, and look at what they're doing. So
I guarantee you this,
a lot of people are going to get that Soundwave masterpiece because they want nothing but Hasbro on the shelf, and they're going to get rid of the
Shockwave, right?
Yeah. The Shockwave, yeah.
So like, Soundwave was 2 years ago.
Wasn't there a third-party Soundwave
in the works, and then they dumped it immediately?
I meant Shockwave, sorry guys.
I think they ran away screaming when they saw the Platinum one.
Probably.
Don?
Oh no, I just gonna say I don't think people will be so quick to dump the Quake Wave because it has a very classics looking vibe to it. It's like, I mean, again,
people were pissed off about the LED in the head.
Yeah.
Well, I know a lot of people that are pissed off about that LED in the head. They pay X amount of money for this thing, and it better damn well work, and it didn't work, and they're mad about it, and I don't blame them.
But again, you know, it's like, are you collecting it for G1, or do you have a classic shelf that you've already got your Shockwave or your Quakewave as your classic Shockwave, and then you've got your Masterpieces? The two are kind of different universes representing two different versions of the character. So, for some people, one may not replace the other because of where it falls. It's like, I have the Protector armors, but carry is not going to make me sell my Protector Armor Rodimus because different aesthetics for different timelines.
Right.
And I think that's what you're going to be looking at.
But not everybody does that. I know.
Exactly.
I got a good friend of mine, and he collects Masterpiece figures. He wants nothing but Masterpiece versions of these. And if that thing comes out and it's great, Quake Wave will go away. And that's the way it works. Right. You got those guys that want nothing but, they only have the room in their house for Masterpiece figures, and that's it. And that's all they collect. That's why they, okay, I go out and buy the Warbitron, because Hasbro haven't given us a Masterpiece Bruticus. Well, in the future, will they? We don't know. If they don't, okay, cool, he's got one. If they do, well, guess what happens to that one? It goes away. Because people are purists. There are purists out there that will do that.
But I think that's also a very good point for what we were saying earlier, at least what I was saying. Diversity. Mm-hmm. The more diversity the third party has, the more people they'll be able to get despite all these different desires and aesthetics out there. But if they keep doing the same 3 years of worth of characters, they're going to drown in the sameness.
Well, I completely agree with you on that one. Because, I mean, it's like this. I've been jonesing for this for a long time. Why have we not gotten a Generation 2 Starscream Masterpiece? They have redone that mold God knows how many times. What was it, three times? Two or three times when they did the first mold? Now they're doing the same thing with the other ones? G2 would be so easy to do, and there'd be a lot of people who would buy a G2 Masterpiece Starscream. And the same thing with that Ramjet that's coming out.
I just don't think
it's a no-brainer. People would buy
Japan.
I disagree. I think G2, for as much as it's appreciated, is more of a niche market.
Yeah, but why would they give us a G2 Lambor and give us a G2 Bumblebee? And not give us that. Makes no sense.
It could be timing. It could be they could be planning that for show exclusives. I mean, nowadays I'm not surprised. Well, you know,
this is my thing though. They give us an Acid Storm. I get that from the classics one. But was there really anything before that? No. Same thing with that Sunstorm they did. So, honestly, those are niche figures. Barely anybody wants those as well. So why not just the G2 ones? It'd be simple. They'd be able to stick it with the actual stuff that really came out for those that are wanting a Masterpiece shelf that has real figures that actually were in...
They know for a fact that you want three versions of the same Starscream. I mean,
I want one version of Starscream and one version of Ramjet, and I really wish they would get off their high horse and give us a Masterpiece Megatron that is a freaking tank.
It's going
to be simple and easy to do, and you'd be able to repaint that thing three or four different times.
It's going to get to the
buy.
It's
right here. Right here.
Hey, I've got one, and mine's green.
It's going to get to the point where the Masterpiece Starscream mold is going to be like the classic Starscream mold.
Yep.
And we're going to be getting that ad infinitum for the next...
It already is.
Yeah, right, but there's never been released in Gen 2. There's never been a Generation 2 version of it.
I don't think there ever will. The problem is that your Masterpiece market is driven by Takara, and G2 is... Like, you brought up the G2 Lambor and the G2 Bumblebee, and those are just products. I feel those are more products of just trying to get the most out of the mold.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, okay, I understand
Bumblebee. That's a product of convenience.
Yes.
Okay, I can understand Bumblebee, okay? Bumblebee, Gold Bug, as people want to call it, because he's gold. Because in G1 he was known as that, and they got the different faceplates and stuff. Okay, they gave us the G2 logo for it, so that way it's Generation 2 because it's shiny. But honestly, where have they ever asked, and anybody ever asked, for a G2 Masterpiece Sideswipe?
Japan loves black repaints.
Well, then why? I mean, my thing is they repainted him.
But Sideswipe is sort of the...
For them to get money back with the mold, that's what I'm saying. They need to do that.
And it's the same thing with the Grimlock.
Grimlock, they gave us a blue one.
When you think about G2, especially the comics, there's one comic cover that probably pops up in your head, and that's the one with him, you know, teeth and slobber and, you know, those...
That's actually a cell inside the comic. It's not on a cover.
But see, on the covers, even when I was unfamiliar with it...
On the covers, you see the one, the most popular one is Optimus Prime. It's all beat up and he's got a gunshot shell stuck in his head.
Yes.
That's the most popular cover scene.
Why am I talking about their cell then? I mean, that's one I even knew about when I saw the G2 Lambor. I don't know much about G2, but I was like, holy crap, that thing's cool.
But my thing is, if you've read the comics, there's a lot of people out there that have read the comics, and they agree that comic book series was very dark, very gritty. It should have became a cartoon because it was really well done.
Dark the and comic gritty wasn't really very time period.
Yes. Look at G.I. Joe back then. It was dark and gritty and just extreme and crazy, and that's exactly...
I remember them going to outer space, Mortal Kombat, and Street Fighter about that time period. that wasn't very gritty. I remember the commercial for the Street Fighter G.I. Joe.
I'm referring that to what Hasbro decided to do with G.I. Joe at the time. Do you guys remember the G.I. Joe series from the 90s?
G.I. Joe Extreme?
Yes, it was very, like, dark, celled, shaded, and it was silly. But that was the aesthetic back then for everything. And that's what I'm saying is the people that have read the comic books, they even agree that those comic books were very well done. And they do deserve the respect because you do have a resurgence of the people that did collect strictly G2 back then, that wanted G2. That's what they saw. When they saw Optimus Prime on the shelf, they saw him with a black trailer.
Yeah, I just think from Takara's standpoint, it's not a large enough market. Bumblebee's going to sell because he's Bumblebee. I feel like that Lambor is, or that version of G2 Sideswipe is iconic for G2, for the G2 line.
Yeah, I mean, he really does kind of, I mean, when you look at him, it kind of just, you can almost see like the whole cartoon
in
your head in the comic book just from that one character. Yeah. But it would be cool to see them do that with the other molds that I'm saying. I mean, okay, they're going to give us a Masterpiece Ramjet. What else are they going to paint that as?
Well, it's a limited release, so nothing.
It's going to be a limited release, and I guarantee you this, they're going to probably want to reuse that mold at least another time. And it will be a G2 version. They would have to. Why? What are they going to do? They're going to repaint it gold as like a lucky draw or something?
No.
Of course.
are they really going to go through the aesthetic and go through and try to remold the wings to make the other Seekers out of it? No, they're probably not going to do that. I doubt that. I think it's a one-off. And much like Grimlock, we only got a Masterpiece Grimlock. We never got the rest of Dinobots.
I'm willing to wager that on that Ramjet mold, that they already have the other wings as part of that mold. They just have those blocked off. And in the future, we'll probably see that released as Dirge and as Thrust. Because Thrust had the standard null rays, you know, the standard Starscream missiles and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So the only odd man out would be Dirge and his little machine guns. And that I could see them maybe just reusing Ramjets. If they wanted to, they'll probably end up with Dirge machine guns.
Well, those just give you the same stuff that the rest of them came with, because that's what they do.
Well, we are way off topic from the third party. So,
but I mean, I had to get that out there. I mean, I don't know if any of you guys agree with me, but it's a no-brainer. I don't know why it's not happening.
So, I guess driving us back to the third party discussion, the third party bubble. Does anyone else have any thoughts on that?
Well, since I didn't get to go, it'd be nice.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, Brett. I'm going to go hide in a hole now.
I mean, I guess I got a, you know, a little bit of thought on it. That's all right. And I'm going to go against probably almost everything you all said.
Cool.
I think that they need to stay smaller companies. I think that they're all fighting for the almighty dollar from all of us. I think that they'll stay strong because Hasbro is not going to put out all the products that we want. And therefore, there's going to be a gap that they are fulfilling. So I would go against almost everything you all said just because of that. I don't think that they're going to end anytime soon. I think third parties are here. And like I said, if they get too big, they're going to get on the radar of Hasbro, and there's going to be repercussions. But I think why they need to stay
and reproductions.
I said repercussions.
And reproductions. They'll be both.
Listen, G2 guy that won't shut up for 2 hours. All right? In any case, no. I don't think they're, And the other thing, saying that they should just stick to kits and $30 kits and this, that, and the other. No, they want to make money. They're going to put out the $500, $600 figures that we're all going to buy. And then when the next one comes out, we're going to dump that and we're going to buy the next one because that's what we do. That's what this fandom does.
Do you really think that the figures make more than kits?
Yes. Yes, I do. Otherwise, they wouldn't keep doing them.
I mean, they obviously make money, but I don't know. I feel like the kits get a pass from even people who are staunch anti-third party because they're modifying their official figure. Where, I mean, because we used to see this. I mean, and that back when third party was beginning, you had the City Commander and stuff like that, which actually, when that stuff was releasing, was driving up the price of official figures
mm-hmm.
on the aftermarket. And those things were selling like hotcakes.
Cliffjumper.
It still feels like, you know, anything that you can use to upgrade your official figures sells like it's going out of business.
Well, then let me ask you this. Since back then, that's all you got was kits, and they sold so well, then why don't you see more kits instead of new figures? Complete figures, because complete figures make more money, they sell, and we're going to buy them.
It's also boiling down to the way the fandom's being, because you got the guys out there right now that are even hating on the Combiner Wars line, saying, oh, repaint, and they're like, oh, I'm not going to buy them anymore because they're all our repaints. Well, that's also a factor. But, I mean, it isn't like it used to be years back where everybody wanted that Ultra Magnus that they never gave us, and then they were like, oh, we'll just build an add-on kit for it to make it, and then it blew up. Now they make a full-on Ultra Magnus that tries to be Masterpiece scale and everything to rival with the actual Masterpiece. They have to bump their game up, but to be honest, you got guys like me, they buy add-ons for Lambor and Wheeljack and stuff like that, and
I believe you're in the minority.
I don't know. There's a lot of people that are buying Masterpiece add-ons.
I'm telling you right now, I think there's more people buying full-blown figures from third-party. Yeah. And as long as we're going to buy it, they're going to make it. Now, I'll give you another perfect example, and Don will agree with me on this because we talked about it before. When that, what was it called? Ammunition and Explorer. That kit, when mm-hmm. it came out, you and I both know we liked Bruticus. That was the be-all Bruticus.
Yep.
Then Warbitron came out. Holy crap! Got to get Warbitron. Now that's the be-all of Bruticus until the next one comes out. And we'll buy it.
But that's also for me, I'm not sure about you, but that's because I like Bruticus. There's very few companies that I'll keep buying the same character for. I might buy the repaints if it's a different enough repaint or whatever, but Bruticus is my favorite American combiner.
Same here.
So I'm gonna, yeah, so I'm gonna keep buying the versions that I like. Now, I even have the Ruination version of the Fall of Cybertron one. I haven't opened them yet because I like them kind of like the way they are on card. Because that Fall of Cybertron is just not great. But, you know, I'll keep buying Bruticae as they come out.
Same here, and I agree. But we're not the only ones. So I feel solid. I haven't seen anything that makes me think otherwise. That they're here. They're here, and if they're smart, they'll start being more diverse, and then you're gonna see Brave, Power Rangers, whatever the next thing for them is gonna be to keep expanding.
I've said the first person. Third party, Hasbro, whatever the case may be, that gets me a Devastator in Guard City colors is probably going to get my money because I can't afford a Guard City. I could afford a Guard City. I could afford a Battle Gaia if I didn't do anything else, go anywhere, do anything, and ate bologna for the next year.
Not to mention the simple fact of finding them is hard enough.
Exactly.
No, that's the key is trying to find those guys, yeah. And I know those things are stupid, ridiculous to find.
Right. So, you know, there are certain characters where third parties is like, okay, we're not going to get at least now. Takara, they may redo their Defensor as Guard City. I can't see them not doing it for the Japanese market. But will it be a Takara Tomy Mall exclusive like Ramjet? Will it be a Hasbro Asia or a whatever the case may be for Asia exclusive? Who knows? But that's
never what know. They might just do flat cartoon colors or something.
Yeah. So that's what third party needs to look at is the things that we're not going to be getting from Hasbro and Takara, like TFC. I love Hercules. I still like Hercules. But we've all talked about how TFC really has not grown in their design aesthetics. Everything still is following the same similar design aesthetic. But they are doing Lyokaiser, which I am very, very interested in because I have Lyokaiser. I'm afraid to touch him anymore.
Right.
So, again, they're doing...
We also have the Dino King that's coming out, too. And that's the thing. You don't have anything rivaling those two yet. But that's not to say somebody isn't.
It's right here. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Dino King. But real quick, there's one other thing Anthony, I'm sorry, I'm not even going to butcher your last name. He asked, what's our favorite third-party company? And I'm going to go first this time. And what I think, I like the Not Bruticus. So... You know, Warbitron. That's my favorite figure, so that's who I'm going with. Don?
Oh, I can't pick one because everyone, DX9 did carry. Fans Toys are doing the Dinobots.
Mm-hmm.
You've got Mastermind doing like the Hearts of Steel and Cyclops and things like that.
But you had
like
to pick one.
I had to pick one. Probably Fans Project, but that's with a giant, huge asterisk right beside of it.
Fair enough. Jim, do you even have any third-party stuff?
No.
Kind of pointless, then.
I have to say, though, probably out of anything third-party that's just not official Transformer or official Hasbro per se, probably the little commander sets that came out in the final SlaggerCon in 2013.
Good one.
Outside of that.
Wake up.
I've technically only ever bought three third-party items, and that is a set of repro label Autobot symbols and Decepticon symbols, iGear's Cuphead replacement, and the Unicron.com animated accessory pack. So I'm not very fluent in the whole third-party business.
Well, heck, you could probably go with repo labels then, because that's a third party.
It is
company, you know. So I've been tempted by more. I just don't label my stuff other than Insignia. Yeah.
I don't either. I mean, I like what repo labels does. Like, it's great for people out there trying to, you know, go and restore a figure, you know, that has crap stickers. I hate stickers. I don't want G1 figures because they have stickers. You know, I don't like putting stickers on things because I'm terrible at it, and then I hate my figure once I'm done because the stickers look crap.
All you have to do is take the G1 figure and play with it in the tub. Sticker won't be a problem after that. You're good.
So, but if I had to give it to someone, I guess I would give it to Repro Labels because they're really a service to lots of different types of collectors.
Fair enough. Jason?
I honestly am going to go with Fans Project, just like Don. Not just because I had the Glacial Bots, because it is a phenomenal piece, but I have handled a lot of their product before, and their product's pretty good. I mean, honestly, I think when they first started kicking off with the Bruticus that we were just talking about earlier, just they knew what they were doing, they know what they were going for, and they honestly really haven't let anybody down when it comes to quality. Sometimes when it comes to trying to get a hold of the figure, it's a lot harder, and sometimes they had to kind of pull back a little bit because they didn't really have a lot of the stock. But to be honest, from what I heard, even their customer base is like their customer service is really
well. So I'm sitting here trying to think of every single third-party company, and I can't think of one that didn't have some quality control issue, at least one, in all the toys. I mean, everyone's got their good ones and bad ones. Mm-hmm. So, and that's the other reason why I like the fact that I can choose. You know, this company does this one right, okay? But I like this one over this one because he does this one right. You know, so on. So I still feel that having the separate companies gives you more choice. It gets you more options. So we're not just stuck with, well, this is all we got. So, you know, and as far as your favorite goes, just because I like one doesn't mean I'm not picky. I'll go with whatever I like at the time, and that's the company. So.
Well, I have a little thing I kind of want to say, but I would love to see a third party tackle this. Shogun Warriors that are the same size, the large ones, that are articulated and don't cost a fortune. I would love to see an entire line of those. Like, what was it? Isn't there like 30 different ones close to it? That would be amazing to see an entire line of Shogun Warriors that are released that are articulated, that are that high.
There's a lot of them.
That would just be phenomenal. And that would be something a third-party company could easily tackle.
And
they would fill in a large niche for Super Sentai. I mean, there's a lot of guys I know that really collect the die-cast ones, but I know there's a ton out there that are collecting the Shogun Warriors, just the jumbos.
And
they're just so cool.
And they could do the one Aaron Archer mentioned at, I want to say TFCon, that he mentioned that he wanted to do a 2-foot-tall jump, a Shogun Warrior Optimus Prime with launching fists and everything. I would have to probably buy that if a third party did. I'd be afraid of the cost, but a launching fist Optimus Prime.
It'd be even better if, like, the doors on his chest opened and he shot out, like, freaking titty missiles. I'm sorry. It'd be funny. That's like an iconic thing with Shogun Warriors. A lot of
we've talked about this before.
Right, yeah. Because Guy King's awesome. He's the shit. He also turns into a dragon. But most people don't know that, though.
Well, I did want to see if I could get every single question answered. So there's a couple more I wanted to get to. I cannot pronounce his name at all. I'm sorry. I'm horrible.
Can you spell it?
That guy.
Y-I-N-A-N.
Whining?
Okay, we'll go with that. He asked were the top 10 figures of 2015 the best and the worst, but I think we're going to hold off on that towards the end of the year.
Yeah.
On that one.
Yeah.
So that topic, we're going to...
To be fair.
We're going to get to that. We'll get to that one. Okay?
That's a New Year's special.
James asked about, as far as the G1 Jazz from the Cookie Crisp, and I responded to that because I actually had one, and so that one was kind of answered. Third party was answered.
Okay, well, quick question, Brett.
Yeah.
What about the Wonder Bread He-Man? Can you answer that one for me?
To be honest with you, I just had a debate over that 2 days ago in one of the He-Man forums. And
I've never heard a definitive answer on that before.
I'm trying to remember the name of it. There's a group of guys that help out with one of the fan sites that actually has a bagged, sealed one, and it only came with the axe and the sword.
But it does exist.
Yeah. Oh, I've had Wonder Bread. I've had three of them.
Okay.
But I've never had one with weapons. They've always been just the figure. Now, the rumor is that it also came with armor and everything else, but that's beside the point. The closest I've heard is one guy, it's actually brothers. They have one sealed with just the two weapons, but it also had a promotion in there that was not Wonder Bread. So that brought up even more speculations.
Okay.
So for that answer...
The world may never know.
And it might be one of those. It might be.
So Wonder Bread will keep us wondering.
They will keep you wondering. All right. I'm checking.
Right.
Emmett asked a question about Fun Pub and the license and all this, that, and the other. And Michael answered it pretty easily. I mean, all we're going to be doing is speculating because no one knows. So we're going to kind of leave that one alone.
Yeah, we're not poking the bear on that one.
Yeah. Now, the last one was Gavin. And once again, we looked at this and we said, we're not going to tackle this, but we're going to go ahead and tackle this. He talked about what are our thoughts on the sexism of Victorion being a breastmaster. And I was the first one, jumped up really quickly and said, I'll go on record as saying that it would have to be a female because otherwise no one would want to see Breastmaster from a guy. So I went on record as saying that. Anyone else have thoughts on it?
Velocitron!
That was my fault.
I'm going to say it's not sexist because you had the breast force from Japan.
I knew you were going to bring that up.
I know, and they were all guys. But if you attribute... Anyway, it's part of the transformation to add armor. It doesn't... We're applying human attributes to mechanical beings that doesn't really have the same context.
Right.
It's just armor for armor's sake, if you want to get down to it. The toy has a place for it. The toy's going to have a place for it.
Just look at Defensor here. Groot is supposed to be a chest plate, a set of armor for the vitals of Defensor, of Hotspot. He's not meant to transform into a pair of you-know-what.
So, I mean, it's not sexist because it's part of the toy. It's part of the mythos that you, whenever you combine, you add armor. It's kind of dumb to make that into a thing. I'm not saying the question's dumb. I'm just saying people raising their flags and staking out camps and stuff.
That would be about as sexist as this. And this
are
not
people
sexist.
Are people really raising their flags?
If they make a chest plate, well, what if the chest plate fired missiles from the chest?
Okay. I'm going to bring up this. Look at Overlord with Giga and Mega. Is that sexist? They're married. They are a married couple that are Power Masters. They're also evil, but they're married as well. Is this that is sexist? So no, it's the way they control the character.
Well, you're kind of opening up like a broad, so I guess.
Not healthy.
Want to go there?
By the way, I want to thank Gavin for starting this wonderful topic of discussion that we find ourselves in at this point. Yeah.
So I don't think it's sexist. If you think it is, you've got nothing else in the world to worry about then, apparently.
This is a
non-issue.
I just think that Groove and Blackjack and Rodimus and whatever the name of the character is from Victorian, need to go and get together and go form their own faction where they're not worn on the chest of another robot as a sacrificial lamb.
And see, then you can have Kimberly join because of the pink pterodactyl.
Coming from the Church of Cyburn.
You know, I'll be honest with you. When you started talking and you named all the characters whom I attribute to be female, and you said they all had to get together, and I was really thinking a whole different way with that. Not a good way either. I'm gonna leave it alone.
They formed their own combiner.
You said they formed their own, and I was like, oh crap.
Horrific mental picture.
Yep, okay. It did. But anyway, now, the next question. Zach,
yes, thank you.
A random question, and I was going to pose this at Don. He said, do you think Unite Warriors Devi would fit in with the Masterpiece line?
Me specifically?
Yeah, I'm asking you.
Oh, in scale, probably, but from a aesthetics and a material, the way the material looks on Devastator and his aesthetics, not perfect, because this G1 Devastator he doesn't have the fit and finish of a Masterpiece. From a scale point, he would work fine, but I think from a visual look, it would be not a good fit.
If I recall, I want to say that Brett and I agreed on this a while back when we were discussing this, that whether it be Unite Warriors or Combiner Wars or whatever, you know, Comic-Con, that Devastator mold, in essence, is essentially Masterpiece Devastator.
Oh, yeah. I mean, from an engineering and standpoint, it is. It's just saying... from a scale standpoint, yes, but a visual standpoint, it really wouldn't fit on a Masterpiece shelf.
I don't know. It depends on if you're asking Devastator. I think Devastator, I don't think that an official Masterpiece Devastator is going to pull off Devastator that much better than this one already does. When combined, except for maybe, you know, the mixed master leg, we can get into all of that. But I think combined, he is amazing. He looks like he stepped out of the cartoon. Now, when you're going to the individual robots, no. They do not, they are not masterpieces.
Here's the problem. If the other companies, like, I look over on my combiner shelf, which happens to be, you know, Warbitron, you know, Feral Rex, they even have the Glacial Lords over there. But, you know, I'm looking at all those, and I look at the Abominus, the Bruticus, the Minasaur, and the Predaking. They all look very much alike. And then I look at Devastator, and he does look very cartoonish. So it kind of doesn't fit that way, but I still think it fits enough that he is my Devastator for my masterpiece. So I agree with you.
Well, cartoonish.
It's one of those things, yeah, he's really cartoonish. If the others were more cartoonish, they'd all fit in. Devastator was more detailed, then he would fit with the other one. But I think they're still good.
On that thought, I just like last week, I was noticing this. And when Michael, you mentioned the Mixmaster, I noticed this Devastator, Combiner Wars, Unite Warriors, whatever you want to call it, Devastator, is a specific Devastator from a specific scene. If you pay attention in the Transformers movie, the way Mixmaster transforms when they merge for the kill in that scene in Autobot City, the same way he transforms here in the toy. The cab is at the knee in that scene.
Really?
Yep.
I think Brett's looking at it.
Blew my mind.
Yep.
Well, I mean, I myself actually getting a chance to, because I don't have one yet.
Yeah.
I'm really hoping to do it in yellow or orange.
You're
going to
get three.
But, no, I'll only get two.
Okay.
I only collect G2, remember.
Okay.
But I've played with the toy, and it's actually not bad quality. A lot of people complain. Well, the people that are complaining are normally the ones that ham-fist their toys. There's a lot of them that do. Some might not, and they might be the guy that got the quality control one or whatever. But to be honest, aesthetic-wise, I think it looks great with the rest of the boss. I think it literally, like, the scale is there. It's big enough to be a masterpiece. It's like when you put it up next to the Metroplex, it scales well with everything. So I think it's actually a good one, but when you're looking at, like, price point, I mean, you're not going to beat that price. You're just not.
Real quick, Don, Zach, once again, he asked a question, but this time he specifically asked you.
Okay.
He says, this is just for Don. What do you think the likelihood of a true masterpiece Debbie actually is?
Well, I think the designer of Devastator, I can't remember the gentleman's name, but I think he's gone on record saying he designed that to be a masterpiece quality figure. So I don't think we're going to see a Devastator as an actual black box masterpiece figure for a long time, because there's too many other characters that have not been done that they can get remolds out of, that Devastator would cost so much money and have a lot more limited recolors available than what the Masterpiece line usually is focusing on. So I do not think we're going to see one. I would say it's probably going to be at least several years before we see it. Now, if we keep seeing small Autobots like Bumblebee, we get a Cliff Jumper, we get a Beachcomber. If we start seeing these smaller bots with different models come out, we may see a Devastator, because they could be using these smaller figures to see how they stand up with tolerances and everything else. Again, the problem is, though, with masterpiece vehicle modes, you wouldn't have a dump truck the size of Bumblebee, because that's not how big a dump truck actually is. So I don't think we're going to see it. I think we've got our Masterpiece Devastator for some time, but you do have the new Gravity Builder coming out, so we might see it in a third party. We'll just have to wait and see.
Yeah. Well, Zach, I wanted to finish up your question real quick, just by letting you know that I actually have a lot of insight on that particular question and on that particular model. I actually do know the true answer to that, but because you didn't ask me, I'm not going to tell you. So, Mike, I think we're about done, don't you think?
I think so.
Okay.
I think there was one more question, and I think we all answered it before the podcast If there is a fight to the death, which cast member wins? It's pretty much unanimous that Brett kills everyone.
That's just because I have more guns.
Exactly.
It'd be
and
me.
A whole training.
it would be me. I've got
guns.
I'm like the TFYLP version of Deadpool. What are you talking about?
I would not.
I'm the GoBot version. Leave me alone.
At all. Not at all.
That's because I have to keep it rated G for the TFYLP audience.
This is about as rated G as you're going to get. This comparison I could think of.
It's a Marvel DC crossover, and he's Bizarro Deadpool.
Okay. All right. Okay. Here, one quick question. In this question, are we including Massey or not?
Sure.
We're not including Massey. Massey is just a win by default.
Okay.
And it's not really fair to put Massey into that.
Massey's like Exodia from Yu-Gi-Oh.
Exactly.
Know. It's still win if you got him.
Here's the problem with that. While I'm not a real big cat lover, and everyone knows this, I wouldn't hurt a cat. I don't have a problem hurting a person, but a cat, no. So, yeah, he would win.
So Aaron Doyle says hand-to-hand, and it's still the same hand-to-hand. If it's hand-to-hand, yeah. Brett's still beating the crap out of all of us.
But if it ever degenerates into a hand-to-hand combat, I will not make it. But if I'm going to go down, I want the Star Trek fight music playing.
Absolutely.
Because if I'm going down, I want to go down to that.
I just want a Rocky-style picture finish, you know, and that's what they show in the newspaper right before my teeth come flying out of my mouth.
I get the feeling mine would probably involve the Benny Hill theme.
I see Brett with his foot on Jim's feet. And he's going like Bluto and Popeye, just hit him, he bounces back up, and he hit him, he bounces back up, and he hits him again, he bounces back up. It's like...
Yeah, I don't know, I think it'd be more like the clown in Uncle Buck.
There you go.
And on that note...
Yeah, so that was a interesting... Listener question-filled episode of Transformers for your listening pleasure. I want to remind everyone that they can go to Facebook and Twitter and find us on both, and you can join in on discussions with fellow fans and have some fun. Ask us questions, and sometimes we'll answer them, and sometimes we'll have an entire show of rambling where you are the center stage. So you can find us on Facebook, Transformers for your listening pleasure, on Twitter at tfylp.com or at tfylp. You can also find us at tfylp.com or tftalk.net. That'll take you to the same website.
And with the holidays coming up, please be sure to visit our sponsors, Mega Toy Fan and CapturePrey.com. You know, this is the season for, you know, and if you want to give something, you know, let them know what you're looking for, and I'm sure they can suggest something. Heck, you know, ask us. You know, make it part of your question. I'm looking for a gift for so-and-so. We'll be glad to give out recommendations.
Right. Just remember, the other thing is if you respond and we do answer your question, then you get a chance for us to really butcher your name, which I'm very good at. You get that going for you.
It's all part of the service.
That's right. That's free. It's free.
Can't be
free sometimes. Recognition.
Sometimes you just want someone to butcher your name.
And don't forget, speaking of Christmas and all that, coming up here in just a couple weeks, we have our special Christmas episode.
That's right.
Next on a very special episode of TFYLP.
Seems like a soap opera. that was like an intro to a soap opera.
These are the days of our lives.
As the cat claws.
Don't get it. He's asleep in his box. Don't give me that. All right.
The part of Brett will now be played by a vertically challenged ferret.
That can still kick your ass. You got it.
vertically challenged.
Sure, it's not a honey badger.
No, not entirely. I think with rodents.
All right, you crazy people.
All right.
Tell everyone goodbye.
Goodbye, everybody.
Bye, everybody.
Goodbye.
Later.
Special shout out to Peter Spellos. You're awesome. Hope you're watching.
All right. This has been an episode of TFYLP. We'll see you next time.